He touched me. Oh, he touched me. And now there's joy that floods my soul. Hi, dear friends. Pastor Dan here. Now, if you're joining us for the first time, as always, I want to welcome you as we gather together around God's holy and infallible word that is, as I always say and believe with all my heart, is the only word of absolute truth going out in our nation today. And for that matter, any other. Dear friends, if you are blessed, if you're uplifted or in any way challenged by our study, then I invite you to ring the bell and subscribe. That way you're always going to know when we're having a new study. And dear friends, that's going to become increasingly important because, as you know, we're on a journey following Jesus through 1 John, and then we are going into the Gospel of John, and after that, finally, to the revelation of Jesus Christ, where all the fake news of the world will become real news, and you'll know what's going on. Now, today in our study, we'll continue, as I say, following Jesus through the first epistle of John. And I suppose, for lack of a better name, if I were to give it a name, it would still have to be along the lines of Jesus in 1 John, chapter 5, part 1. So with that, let's open our Bibles to the epistle of 1 John, chapter 5, beginning with verse 1. And dear friends, as I like to do in a way of a little bit of review, last week, of course, we finished chapter 4, which is why we're going to chapter 5, and John's extensive treatise on the love of God and how it relates to our love for his family. Now, I've often heard, and as I'm sure you have, that the 13th chapter of 1 Corinthians is referred to as the love chapter. But I believe that John has surpassed that, for one could easily call 1 John the epistle of love. And you should recall that in the first chapter of John presented God as light. And then in that rather extensive center section, chapter 2 through 4, he presented God as love. Now, as we follow Jesus into the fifth and last chapter, we will see John presenting God as life. And so you have the three L's: light, love, life. All of these characteristics of the nature of God will be revisited when we follow Jesus into the Gospel of John. And so that brings us now to the last chapter of our journey through this wonderful epistle of 1 John. John writes in the first verse of chapter 5, "Whoever believes that Jesus is the Christ is born of God, and everyone who loves him who begot also loves him who is begotten of him." And as I've said before on our journey through this epistle, it's simply not enough to believe in Jesus the man. The world, you know, is full of those who believe something about Jesus. The only person that will deny his place in history is one with the same mentality as a Holocaust denier. The world is replete with religious-sounding opinions about Jesus, and dear ones, they're all meaningless. Unless one fully embraces, one fully believes that Jesus is, as verse 1 states, the Christ, or the anointed one of God, not a anointed one of God, but the, meaning the only, anointed one of God, they are still lost in their sin. Those who at least have some kind of religious-oriented belief will at least feel better about themselves, but dear ones, they're as lost as if they had no belief at all, simply not born again. And so the question is, where do you stand in your belief? The word "believes" makes this confession a continuous, ongoing reality in your life, because the second half of verse 1 once again includes the ethical dimension of love that's only made possible through a true born-again experience. One would be mistaken to think that John is in any way promoting mere intellectual assent as a requirement of being a child of God. It is, as he says in his gospel in chapter 1, verse 12, "To all who received him, Jesus Christ, to them who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God." It goes on to say, "Who are born not of the blood, nor the flesh, nor the will of men, but of God." Born again. And thus you have the clause in verse 1, everyone who loves him who begot, meaning God, also loves him who is begotten of him, meaning the family of God. Even though it's there, you need to see that John is not trying to show how a person experiences the new birth. His aim in verse 1 is to once again indicate the evidence of a child of God, and that is that he or she holds to the true faith about Jesus and loves the family of God. John goes on into verse 2, by this we know that we love the children of God when we love God and keep his commandments. John has been saying all along that it's impossible to love God and not love his children. Now, without changing the argument, he reverses it and tells us it's impossible to love the children of God without loving God. Brotherly love is proof of the love of God, but the reverse is equally true. Just as it's impossible to love God without loving his children, so it's impossible to love his children without loving God. In other words, love of God, love of his children confirm and prove each other. And once again, the commandments spoken of here are not the Ten Commandments, though they are met in love's commandment. And so again, the commands are those of our Lord Jesus Christ, and they are, as John says, primarily fulfilled in love. John goes on in verse 3, for this is the love of God, that we keep his commandments, and his commandments are not burdensome. The statement, his commandments are not burdensome, does not mean that God's laws are not exacting or demanding. It means that God's law is in Christ are not oppressive or crushing. In other words, unlike the Ten Commandments, they are not a terrible weight we cannot bear. It is as Jesus said in Matthew 11, my yoke is easy and my burden is light. God's command, anchored in love, frees believers to be the people that they were originally created to be. Remember, what the law demands, grace supplies, and love fulfills. John goes on in verse 4, for whatever is born of God overcomes the world. And this is the victory that has overcome the world, our faith. That is your faith, dear ones. It's easily overlooked, but John has switched from whoever to whatever. It's not just the person born of God that John has in mind. It's the power behind that person. Jesus said in John 16:33, in the world you will have tribulation, be of good cheer. I have overcome the world. That phrase, be of good cheer, carries the meaning of being confident, being courageous. And now the victor imparts to us the victory that is truly his, and he has given us the engaging power of faith in him. When we place our trust in God, he gives us peace in the midst of pressure. Daily victory is ours for the taking, but we must exercise faith in Christ and be active in our pursuit of God. John goes on in verse 5. He says, who is he who overcomes the world? But he who believes that Jesus is the Son of God. When you and I truly trust Christ, it's not a question of our own power. We are kept by the power of God through faith. We have faith in Christ for salvation in the future and faith in Christ for salvation from the world here and now. It is as Paul said in Romans 8:36 and 37. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? Listen, in all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. And so John tells you in verse 5, through your faith in Christ, dear ones, you are an overcomer. Verse 6, John says, this is he who came by water and blood, Jesus Christ. Not by water, but by water and blood. And it is the Spirit who bears witness, because the Spirit is truth. The casual reader won't notice, but you as a person of the word will notice that verse 6 is a continuation of the thought of verse 5. The opening three words, this is he, is of course a continuation of the phrase that preceded it. So what you have is Jesus is the Son of God, and this is he who came by water and blood, Jesus Christ. And while there are those who believe that water refers solely to the word, and while that thought may be there, I tend to lean in the direction of those who refer to the water and blood as the terminal points of Jesus' earthly ministry, namely his baptism, water, and his crucifixion, blood. Jesus came into his power by the baptism, water. You'll recall this was when the Holy Spirit came upon him. And it was here that John the Baptist heard the voice of God say, "This is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased." It was only after this that the Holy Spirit drove him into the wilderness for his encounter with Satan. And Jesus' ministry was made complete by the blood of his crucifixion. This opening statement in verse 6 then points us to the earthly ministry of Jesus Christ from his baptism to his crucifixion. And this is important because it counters the false teachings of the Gnostics who are denying the humanity of Jesus. And thus John emphasizes the reality of the incarnation even more sternly with the words, "not only by water, but by water and blood." And this serves as a direct renunciation of the false teachings that claim that Jesus was born an ordinary human being, but became God's special agent when the heavenly Christ Spirit descended upon him at baptism. And then the same heavenly Christ abandoned him just before his death, leaving only the earthly Jesus to die on the cross. Kind of robs you of all hope. Certainly denies the reality of the gospel. A careful reading by you, the person of the word, will show that in seeking to refute Gnostic teachings, John emphasizes that it was Jesus Christ who experienced both baptism and crucifixion. Jesus the Christ. You must be alert to the fact that today, while so-called theologians that reduce talk of the incarnation to the status of myth may be intellectually attractive or to modern-day men and women, they take away our assurance that God's character is sin-bearing love. No matter what so-called educated theologians with their fancy titles may say, John, with no title but that of apostle, tells us in verse 6 that we have a greater witness to the reality of this statement. And that is the witness of the Holy Spirit. It is, he says, the Spirit who bears witness, because the Spirit is truth. And this is as Jesus said in John chapter 14, verse 15 and 17. He said, "If you love me, keep my commandments. And I will pray the Father, and he will give you another helper, that he may abide with you forever, the Spirit of truth, who the world cannot receive, because it neither sees him nor knows him. But you know him, for he dwells with you," and listen, "and will be in you." There are several scriptures where the Holy Spirit is referred to as the Spirit of truth. And because he is truth, he guides us into all truth. Jesus said, He will give unto you and reveal unto you all that is mine. He is the Spirit of truth. And from the day of Pentecost, in Acts chapter 2, when he was given to the church and filled the believers, he has been the all-powerful, unfailing witness of Jesus Christ from baptism to crucifixion, and now, because of the resurrection, our unfailing witness through the ages. You need to know the early church had no greater witness than you and I have today. We have the same Spirit of truth. The question is, do we avail ourselves to his witness as the early church did? Verse 6 speaks of the witness on earth, but there is yet, seemingly, three more witnesses to the truth of verse 6. John says in verse 7, "For there are three that bear witness in heaven, the Father, the Word, and the Holy Spirit, and these three are one." As a person of the Word, you might find it of interest to know the phrase "in heaven" does not appear in most manuscripts. Consequently, more accurately, it does not appear in many translations. But personally, I believe one could easily say heaven needs no witness. The witness spoken of is in accord with the witness of verse 6. Jesus is the Christ, the anointed one of God, the Son of God. In verse 7, the Father is mentioned first because the other two witnesses have proceeded from him. Without God's gift of love, we would not have the Spirit to make his word come alive in our hearts. Whether it is in the written word of God or in the word himself, he lives. And we have no more reliable witness to that truth than verse 7 gives us, and these three are one. In regard to that phrase, "and these three are one," there is much controversy as to its authenticity. Thus, it's been called the Johannine comma. Some translations omit it, while others include it. But as a prisoner of the word, you just need to know that while the statement may be in many original manuscripts, it is a truthful statement. And as most theologians say, sound theology. Even if the Johannine comma was not in the Bible, the Trinity can still be shown through many other scriptural texts. Like, for example, Jesus himself, in his own words, in Matthew 28:18, said, "All authority has been given to me in heaven and in earth. Go," he says, "make disciples of all nations," listen, "baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit." The same as mentioned in verse 7. "And these three are one and agree as one." John goes on in verse 8. "And there are three that bear witness on earth, the Spirit, the water, and the blood. And these three agree as one." Here you should note that the order has been reversed from verse 7. And this is John's way of showing that here on good old planet Earth, it's the Holy Spirit that testifies through the water and the blood. And that testimony remains forever the same. Jesus is the Christ, or the Messiah, the living Son of God. John goes on in verse 9. "If we receive the witness of men, the witness of God is greater. For this is the witness of God, which he has testified of his Son." Now, I believe it's contextual to say that John has the Gnostic witness in mind here. Not much has changed since John's day. Even today, many people still receive the witness of men. They're taken in by it. They'll believe whatever they read or hear, but they will not receive the greater witness of God. No matter how informative or religious sounding your favorite TV evangelist may be, God's witness is greater, and throughout his word, he gives witness to the deity of his only begotten Son. So, dear ones, go there, go to the word, and be assured of the truth of his witness. Read it out loud, and be assured of the truth of what you hear. Our last verse for today addresses those who receive man's word over God's. He says in verse 10, "He who believes in the Son of God has the witness in himself. He who does not believe God has made him a liar, because he has not believed the testimony that God has given of his Son." The phrase, "the witness in himself," relates back to the anointing of the Holy Spirit mentioned in chapter 2, verse 27, that teaches all things pertaining to God, or for that matter, even the testimony of Scripture that God has given us. Only one who believes that Jesus is the Christ has the inner witness of God. And this is a position that cannot be shaken by mere argument or mere opinion. It can be said that the external witness of Jesus' life becomes the internal certitude. But what about those who reject God's witness and rely on their own so-called intellectualism? God leaves no place for ignorance or misconception. To reject the witness of God is to deny the truthfulness of God. His witness is absolute, and it has been given. It must be either accepted or rejected. There is no middle ground. In denial of Christ, there is no other accepted place you can turn for salvation or for deliverance. It cannot be ignored or explained away. To do so is to make God a liar. And so as we conclude, and you'll want to know that to do so is blasphemy. That being true, one should remember the warning of Jesus in Matthew 12, where he said, every sin of blasphemy will be forgiven men, but the blasphemy against the Spirit will not be forgiven men, either in this life or in the life to come. You cannot change your mind in the life to come. To deny and reject the true witness of God about Jesus Christ is, as the scripture said, to call God a liar. And as I said, it leaves one with no acceptable place to turn, for scripture is clear, as we see in Acts 4:12, nor is there salvation in any other. For there is no other name under heaven, right here on earth, given among men by which we must be saved. Not can be, not could be, but must be saved. For Jesus said, unless you are born again, you cannot enter the kingdom of God. So with that being true, the question you have to deal with is how many precious souls that God has allowed to pass your way have you allowed to go on their way without ever mentioning the name that stands above every name, Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God. What we need to understand with the outshorn amen is that every time we withhold his name, we deny his name. And listen, Jesus said in Matthew 10, whoever denies me before men, him I will also deny before my Father who is in heaven. And dear ones, this same Jesus also said, whoever confesses me before men, him I will also confess before my Father who is in heaven. So how goes it with you? Will it be denial? Or will it be confession? That result is your choice. Let us pray. Father, we thank you for this wonderful epistle that we've been going through. We thank you so much for the love it points us to, the love of God revealed in his only begotten Son, his only unique Son, Jesus Christ, and the cross of Calvary. And Jesus said, because I live, you will live. But you have to believe in him. And so, dear ones, if you're out there today and you joined this study and you see that you don't have this love in your life or the assurance of it, you don't know Jesus Christ as your Lord and as your Savior, or you know about him, maybe you believe in him, sort of, but you don't know him as Lord and Savior. If it's your desire and your heart's cry today to change that, then I invite you to say this prayer with me. Father God, thank you for forgiving my sins, and I confess that I am a sinner. But now, I want to be a sinner saved by grace. And so I surrender my life to you. And I ask and I invite you, Jesus, come into my life. Take control of my life. Be my Lord and my Savior. And I promise, I will, as the Holy Spirit enables me, do the very best I can to live that life for you, and let you live your life through me. Thank you, Father God. Thank you. And now, dear friend, if that prayer was your prayer today, then I want you to know that Jesus has made a promise to you, and that promise will be yours for a lifetime. And you can see it for yourself in Revelation 3:20, where Jesus says, behold, or listen, I stand at the door and knock. And that, dear ones, is the door of your heart. If anyone hears my voice and opens that door as you have, I will come into him and dine with him, He with me. And that's where he is, inside of you, where he will dine with you. And that, dear one, speaks of an ever-increasing fellowship. That only, it just grows stronger and it goes sweeter as the days go by and even as the years go by. And as you engage yourself in God's holy word and in the fellowship of prayer. Now, friends, I hope that you'll join with us next time as we once more gather around God's word and follow Jesus into the conclusion of chapter 5 and this powerful, love-filled epistle of John. Because as I always say, I believe that Father God has something special for us. But until then, God bless and bye-bye.